Thank you, Mr. Falstaff. Okay, number seven, item seven on the agenda, public comments, recognition reporters. We do have a card for a public comment, so we can take that now. Or you can wait until we address 12.1, and we are moving 12.1 up sooner.
Is that,
they can't address 12.1.
Until we open it.
Okay. We will address 12.1 with you when we open it. Let's see. And regarding the overall agenda, to make it easier for folks, because it's before the holidays, and we know why some of you are here, and the card confirms that, is after we get through 9.0, we'll move up 12.1, so that's an early discussion, and then we'll report out on closed session, and then we'll continue with item 10 and on. So having said that, let's move into 8.0, and specifically 8.1, AATA rep, do you have anything to share with us this week?
Nothing to share this week, thank you.
Okay. CSCA rep? Mr. Bean, you have something for us this week?
Yes.
I thought you might.
So we had the, in the last week, we had the first pep rally in the gym, which was a success. The cheer, drum line, the class competition was held, the class fair competition. The Her Winter performance was a holiday hit, having a large crowd of Mustangs showing up in support, including teachers, principal, board members, students, and parents. The boys' soccers are 6-2, and they won the last game on Tuesday against Guidance Charter, 6-1. And the girls' soccer is 10-1, and they won the last game yesterday against St. Bernard, which was a score of 4-1.
Thank you, Mr. Dean. And if you do squeeze out a little early, very happy holidays for you and your family and your fellow students.
Thank you, Mr. Dean.
Thank you.
Happy holidays.
Enjoy the break.
Any relations to James Dean?
Item 8.4, VHS new construction.
Yeah, we're happy to announce that TDM Architects have submitted today phase 3 to DSA. So it's been accepted. It sounds as if they'll have it for about 6 months, and then they'll give us back any changes and we'll take it from there. So.
And on item 8.5, superintendent report.
We did put together an Acton remodeling presentation that we wanted to share with you. And I want to thank Yolanda as she turns around these renderings. She's got beautiful pictures of what our campus will look like. And we have a couple of handouts here for you. Classroom, and we had the opportunity to walk all the teachers that were interested from Meadowlark and postcard that was the 4th and 5th grade teachers that will be meeting with us through all the classrooms and kind of design what it's going to look like. They will come with technology, with smart boards and projectors, document cams, and each class will have a Chrome card. And we've all voted for a cordless phone so that we can pick it up anywhere we are when we're teaching. The playground is equipped right now. We have a new play structure that's in, almost ready to be played on, and we will, from the district office, be taking a quick break to go play on it as soon as it's able. We'll get some pictures for you. And then we have an exercise station for designed for 4th and 5th grade students so that when they take the physical fitness test, they can work out on the vocational station section outside. There'll be handball courts, grass field, basketball courts, and we're redoing the visitor parking lot and the parent parking lot. So the next step and what we're projecting is that the complete renovation should be done about March. We're ordering furniture to be delivered around March, and then we'll start the formal notifications of the staff and the parents, do parent meetings probably in May, the student tour that we talked about last time in June, and look to hire the staff over the summer. And if you remember at the last board meeting, or I'm sorry, budget study, we didn't talk about extra staff, but we needed the library aide, we'll need a teacher for the SDC classroom. We have slotted another counselor to add to the district, and cafeteria workers, aides to work in the specialized programs, as well as the playground supervisor aides. And we should have a grand opening. If there's any questions about that, the following page kind of lays out some of the budget. As you know, we put $1 million aside for this. And the very top number of $296,000 is kind of what we've already spent. We've done painting and tree trimming, we've ordered signage, we've done a little bit of air conditioning, we've talked about the playground equipment, some of the demolition's been done and the environmental testing. I want to point out that we did go in and look at the mold and the asbestos and the lead, and anything that was found was very, very minimal, and we abated all of that, and we will come back in with another company to make sure it's all clean after that. And then those are the projected costs. Again, the numbers can vary, but that's what we're estimating. And at the very bottom, you'll see we're coming in right about $1 million. So we'll have $168,000 or $100 flex. I don't know if there's any questions.
Kim, maybe it's embedded in here and I'm just not seeing it. Do we have the FF&E on one of these line items? Furniture, fixtures, and equipment?
No. That's a separate item.
That's separate from this?
Mm-hmm. And we are just looking, like I said, we have the teachers walk through and kind of design what they wanted their classrooms to look like and what the state learning stations would look like. So we're just starting to pick that out and give it a look.
Can you do these bigger contracts, do they go out to bid, all of them? Or do we have like any relationships pre existing?
There's bid criteria and it depends on the work and the scope.
And the amount. Mm-hmm. So that's all being met?
Mm-hmm. I would still ask that we not wait until May to hold family meetings with 4th and 5th graders. I know we don't have a lot to show them right now. But it's just a political issue with the fact that there's a lot of misinformation. There's a lot of parents who are understandably concerned about the transition. And I think the sooner that we can offer to sit down with them and explain what our purpose is, what the operation would look like conceptually. And, you know, the one thing I constantly get has nothing to do with construction, it has to do with operation, is what's the bell schedule going to be? How are we going to drop off Meadowlark and Acton, and, you know, which way is that going to go? So if that kind of talk goes on too long, it can become corrosive if concerns aren't addressed. So what I'd like to do is just try and hit it sooner rather than later, and then we can follow it up with the other meetings later, where we can talk talk about micro issues, about how things will work and that sort of thing. But I just feel the need to, every time I think I've answered a question and okay, it's good, then it pops up somewhere else. And it's just an ineffective way of doing it. So I think we need to have a daytime meeting and an evening meeting. And if people show up, great. If parents don't show, they've missed their opportunity to get their questions asked. But at least we would have gone through the process of offering that information and extending a hand of communication to them so that they can get some of their concerns addressed. And a lot of it, I think, is just a lot of not knowing.
Change is scary.
So I would want to do that sooner rather than later, at least for that initial meeting, and then we can hold the other meetings and the tours and all that as the project dictates.
Ms. Farley and I, as well as Ms. Fisher, have been sitting down almost weekly and spending a good couple of hours looking at exactly what you're talking about. How are we going to oversee the school? What will the bell schedule be like? And we plan on taking it to the staff. It's a great idea to include the parents and have some parent nights as well. We can do that before April.
Yeah.
Adding on to what Mr. Distasso said, I love the scope of work list because it puts meat on the bones of what does it mean to renovate the school. And certainly it becomes apparent that every room will have technology. It becomes apparent that every room will be remodeled. It wasn't apparent to me until I saw the scope of work, but that included the library and actually remodeling the MPR and the bathrooms. So I think this is wonderful to put meat on the bones. Now what Mark suggested is leaving.
Yep.
And I agree with him, put meat on the bones of how it's going.
Operation, right. And I can't take any credit for this. I need to thank Will and Steve for giving you the budget that you have.
I think the budget's incredible. That's right on the dot. 168. Where are we going to do that? 168 bucks.
Maybe you don't go buy a new purse. Is that enough?
Any other board member discussion?
Good.
Thank you.
Okay. Anything else in the superintendent report that you wanted to mention?
Last time there was a community member that brought up the fact that we had erased some history from VHS and was asked to look into that and see kind of what was going on. So I did work with the principal. As far as the logo on the alma mater, it sounds as if in 2012, when we came upon the school, there wasn't a lot of computer-based left. We didn't have the eye of the cloud in the sky with all the previous documents. So they did set out with ASB and PTO and School Site Council, and they did have to come up with a new logo, as well as a shield and a new song that was generated back in 2012. So that's kind of what we found out about that. As far as the trophies, they are still there. They're on display right now in the library, and there's an Eagle Scout group that's putting together glass cases to go eventually in the gym to house all of the trophies.
I'll just note that part of the thing that we've been trying to do over the past several years is kind of step up the formality and the professionalism of the way in which we run things, and not being able to find and to have less transition certainly can help it, and not being able to find a digital rendering of a logo is kind of symptomatic of the old way, and I could not foresee that we had that happen again. So, you know, that's just what happens sometimes, and it happens when there's a lot of turnover, and it happens when you're not running your school as professionally as you could be.
The only other thing I wanted to point out, I had a few people to thank, Ms. Millar, Ms. Meadle, and Ms. David. I had the opportunity to go to the dancing feet winter dance, and it was fabulous. Equally, Ms. Cesari and Mr. DeVoe, thank you for, as Trevor already mentioned, putting on our first presentation on stage. That was wonderful. The herd did a great job. music. He put on a wonderful presentation here for Cindy. He did a really good job, so I want to thank them for that. Don't forget Christmas Eve. You can watch our Bells program on K. And find out for that, but on PBS, our Bells will be performing at Dorothy Chandler on Christmas Eve at 3 o'clock.
Program starts at 3, and their particular performance is somewhere around 4:15.
That's what I was told.
Okay, yeah, that's my understanding. I have a bell ringer in the house. It will also be rebroadcast at 9 o'clock on Christmas Eve, and again at noon on Christmas Day. Anything else? Ms. Lytle? Okay. Moving on to board member comments. Mr. Paulscraft.
Thank you. First, I would like to say that we attended the ASMO Christmas concert on Monday night. My focus and my days get hung up in driving 3 and 4 hours and dealing with business, and even my focus here is just boom, boom, robot type thing, and it was really good for me to sit there and watch these kids, because especially the little ones, you could see some of them didn't want to sing, some of them wanted to sing, some of them wanted to do more than sing, some were screaming, some were, they were everything, and they were individuals, and they were the hope for our future. So I really very much enjoyed that. I know that the staff put late nights into it. The music instructor is great. There was a lot of inclusion going on with all different kinds of people, so it wasn't just about lining the kids up and, you know, the 60s model that I lived in. So that was very enjoyable, so congratulations to you all. Mrs. Lytle's been babysitting me for a week or so now. I'm very brainwashed into the system I come from, so things are different here, so I very much appreciate your availability and patience. I'm not sure it'll last that long if I keep meeting as much as I do, but thank you. The packet, I've waited 5 years to get a board packet, and when I finally got one, it's great, and I hope that the day will come. There's nothing in there that would freak anybody out. I could even read it, so I would really like to, that's amazing. So I'm going to keep pushing that someday we'll have that available, or anybody that wants to see it can see it. Of course, not closed session stuff, but there's information there. It's very business-like, and it just goes 1, 2, 3, 4, and I think that would be a good improvement. That said, happy holidays. I know that the back row back there, you spend time with kids. God bless you for spending time with my kids, and so enjoy your vacation and come back refreshed and ready to rock and roll again. So thank you.
Mr. Layton?
Yeah. As most of you may know, I've gone to the CSBA convention on earlier part of this month, and we were required to report out. So I will at this time do my head coach duty and report out as how I handled what was going on. Basically, my routine was to wake up and get up at 6 a.m. in the morning and wear a fancy bathrobe that was in the room and take the elevator down, and where they provided me with a free cup of black coffee that I took back to the room. And I arrived there on Tuesday and had sessions on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, and half day Saturday. Wednesday is reserved for basically three types of symposiums. One for new incoming or wannabe presidents of boards. Another one for new and incoming board members that I would have really suggested that Ken go to, but for the fact we didn't know until it was almost over at the CSBA convention, so because of the close election. And then the, I didn't say legal symposium. And I've been to all three of them in over the past years, in the last 9 years, And the one I go to all the time now is, of course, the legal symposium, because I'm very interested in the legal aspect of the running of the school district. And on Wednesday in the legal symposium, I did make a copy of something that's kind of important for our website that I'll just give to administration. It has to do with some new Title IX requirements for our sports programs and the website. We also, at the legal symposium, went over some different statutes, rules, conflict of interest issues to be aware of. And then in the afternoon, there was a not Brown Act 101, which is basically where they try to teach the basics, but it was a more of an advanced Brown Act, and it was done through questions and skits. And usually sitting in the front row, guess who they picked to be in one of the skits? So it was sort of like going to a board meeting that afternoon, only I wasn't a board member. I was somebody from that side. As to the Thursday and Friday and Saturday sessions, I spent the thrust of my classes in charter school teachings, concerns, discussions. It's a little of all that, because we have so many charter schools. And suffice it to say that we're very well known in the area there of charter schools. Also, a part of the legal symposium and the Thursday and Friday charter school sessions, I acquired a lot of materials on the very famous case that will have an effect on all of us, the Anderson Union High School District versus Shasta. I don't know if you four are aware of it or not, but I did get copies of the case and gave them to Ed, who said he would take care of seeing that administration had it so that you can all get copies of that. And there was actually some more materials having to do with charter schools accompanying that. And most of that came from the legal symposium. Other good thing that happened Friday afternoon, I was wearing down a little bit at that point. And the other thing that you do besides going to sessions and classes is they have general sessions where everybody is in one great big room. And before going to the Friday session, I was wore out and tired, but I had enrolled in a bingo contest that is provided for the board members. And only 10 people win it. And I thought, well, I never win anything, but I'm gonna go anyway. So I went ahead and went 30 minutes early for the general session, and they had the bingo. And I'm on the way on the other side of a big room that has all these vendors all over the place, and I hear my name. And acted off with Elsie. And I'm running to get over there, yelling at people, get out of the way, because they say, you're not there, one, two, three, and they pull another name out. Well, what I had won was a $500 certificate for the district to get $500 worth of books. And that you ladies have. And I understand it's going to Meadowlark or something. For the new library, right. So that was a good thing. I would have hated to if somebody said, oh, we heard your name. The general session on the first one was very, very interesting. It was a, had a movie star actor, Edward James Olmos, and he was talking about literacy teachings on the grade levels 4 through 12 through the use of filmmaking. And it, they had some testimonies there from students that had done very well through that. That is basically the my report out for CSBA convention. It was very, I thought it was educational. I thought it was interesting. I did get to attend a dinner with our consulting firm, Ernesto Flores, who is really, I would say, major responsible for our new high school. And Mr. Porter was there also, two of us, and I believe we had a very pleasant evening. And that's it.
All right, thank you, Mr. Baker. Mr. Porter, do you have any comments?
Yes, first and foremost, I want to say Merry Christmas to everyone. And I wish everyone else a Happy New Year. And then secondly, all I really have to say is that to be honest, it deeply saddens me to see Dr. Woodard resign and leave our district due to his health challenges, especially as this comes at a time when various aspects of his long-term vision for our district are coming to full fruition. Brent was largely responsible, in my opinion, for the excellent and skillful planning and construction of our high school, which required several painful restructurings of our plans due to the state's initial unwillingness to provide us the matching portion of our bond. Not to mention that we're also faced with numerous other construction and funding challenges. Not only did he honor his obligation to the board throughout this entire process, he also involved the community in every aspect and in every way. And he got them excited about the whole thing over 8 years, even though we were first building only half of a high school. Later, Dr. Woodard was hugely instrumental in miraculously acquiring a match from the state, with us being one of only a handful of districts out of hundreds to be able to do so, which allowed us to complete 100% of the project and build our phase two, which is our gym, being one of the nicest gyms in LA County, and embark on phase three, our sports fields. Dr. Woodard, through his intricate execution and planning, was also responsible for changing our staff culture in a positive way and fostering an environment of accountability, where the focus is on the classroom, on customer service, on teamwork, and most importantly, by making AADUSD a place where the students truly come first. By doing this, he was able to achieve a goal that certainly evades most educators while they're caught in the tentacles of collective bargaining and budget navigations. Lastly, I don't think anyone can deny the huge professional sacrifices that Dr. Woodard has made in order to develop and manage our charters. Having served two terms as president while working closely with Dr. Woodard over the last 8 years, I feel that I owe him a great debt of gratitude for his integrity, intellect, work ethic, and foresight. His passion towards the children and his unwavering moral compass have been exemplary to witness firsthand. Having said all this, it's understandable that I feel a certain degree of anxiety over his departure and have concerns in regard to making certain to replace him with a person who possesses similar qualities. It remains to be seen if his shoes will be possible to fill, but I do find some comfort in knowing that a couple of years ago, he hired an excellent assistant superintendent, with this important hire of Ms. Kim Lytle being another one of his numerous accomplishments at AADUSD. I look forward to seeing Kim Lytle rise to the occasion, and I will do whatever possible in helping her lead the district through this transition. I wish Dr. Woodard the best in his life and career from this point forward, and I hope that our professional and personal paths cross again sometime in the future when he is in excellent health. That's it.
Thank you, Mr. Porter.
Thank you.
Mr. Distasso?
Yes, I'd also like to publicly give my best to Superintendent Woodard for his years of service to us. He will have a letter to the community coming out, I believe this publication over the weekend. So that'll be forthcoming. And we're also moving it up in the agenda to report out on closed session what our plan is moving forward, so that the community has a clear understanding
as to where we're going. I'd also like to wish staff a Merry Christmas and Happy Holidays and a Happy New Year, and to congratulate all of staff for a successful calendar year. We made a lot of movement over the last 12 months, and professionalism of our staff, the effectiveness of our staff has shown. And lastly, I want to say that while I am generally proud of our student population and their achievements that they make, I have to admit that I am gravely disappointed with some incidents that have occurred at Vasquez High School with the continued vandalism to our bathrooms, which costs money to this district and gives our district a black eye. I have been reviewing staff's actions on this, and it appears that staff is on top of it and dealing with the issue. But at some point, whoever these students are will hopefully be held accountable. And I'm going to say publicly, and I'm just speaking for myself, other board members will have to weigh in, when and if these kinds of actions are placed on an individual, and it can be proven that they are the guilty party, this one board member will seek only the highest degree of discipline and punishment to these kids, including expulsion. I'm going to honestly tell you, I take it personally. I have worked a lot of years to get this school built. I heard, and justifiably so, all of the complaining about the old school and the students and how they thought, what they thought about the old school, and now they have a new one. And this is what we get in return. So I am hoping that fellow students step up to the plate and help to deal with this issue. Well, my understanding is we still don't have the identity of the...
We don't, but the students are really upset about this.
Well, it's one thing to be upset, it's another thing to get down to the bottom of this. And the idea that that we're going to divert money to fix something that was otherwise brand new is just appalling, that they would have this kind of sensitivity. So again, it appears the staff is on top of this issue, and I urge them to do whatever they need to do. And if there's more money that needs to be assigned, I will support it, and I will support nothing less than the most strict discipline for people who are found. And I will end with the issue about vaping incidents that also occurs in our restrooms, which is in of itself bad enough, certainly not as bad as vandalism. But I noticed that with vaping, we don't specifically draw out vaping in our student handbook. And I don't know if we need to. I don't know if staff is comfortable enough. I presume you're going under the smoking aspect. If staff feels that it is more appropriate or more effective to add vaping, then we should consider doing that. I wouldn't suggest we do anything immediately other than the next iteration of the handbook for next year, that we add it on there since it's becoming an increasingly big deal. And I'm going to be honest with you, when we talk about the possession of tobacco and what have you, I don't know if we recognize the possession of the vaping paraphernalia.
It's not just vaping tobacco.
But if that needs to be added on there, I'm certainly willing to entertain an upgrade or an addition to our student handbook. But anyway, again, I'm extremely disappointed that a select number of students would see this as something that they can do, especially to a brand new high school.
And then those stalls are not available to be used by those students. They're closed off.
So anyway, again, thanks to staff for a great year. And that's it, Mike.
Okay. For my part, I'll be brief.
I echo Mr. Porter's comments regarding my experiences working with Dr. Woodard, although for me it was, I only had the privilege for 3 years, and this would have been my first year being acting as president and working more closely with him. He'll be missed, and but I have the highest confidence that Ms. Lytle will see us through the transition. I don't know that everybody is aware of this, but the Friday letters are posted with all the other stuff for the materials for this meeting. And just to call out a couple of things that are out there, because what I found as a parent is when you have your kids in one school, you don't necessarily know what's going on at the other sides. And these letters that you'll find posted with there, are they posted? Ah, well then I'm going to take the opportunity to tell you what's going on at the other sites, because I think it's important that parents at different sites know what their kids will be doing when they move up. So besides the asthma concert that was mentioned, the fifth grade classes started learning about coding at Meadowlark here. It's a small step towards bringing STEAM into Meadowlark. Most of that effort's been up at HDS today, but it is our goal to bring it also here. And thank you to the teachers who also got themselves trained to do that. There were 155 students here who met their first trimester accelerated reading goals, so good news for those. Congratulations to those students and their parents and their teachers. We talked about dancing feet, but thank you to Mrs. Millar and Mrs. Spiegel. It's always teachers who are willing to do more than make these things happen. The 7th and 8th grade theater arts class, is that a new elective? I know we've been enhancing electives. Is that a new elective for this year?
I'm not sure if it is.
Ms. Davis?
It's sort of new. We had a teacher that was doing it last year, but we were borrowing her from Vasquez, so it's the first time that our own teachers are doing it, and it piggybacks with arts, so they flip-flop.
Oh, terrific. So I thought perhaps it was part of the new set of electives, although it's not necessarily STEAM. But having said that, the fact that it isn't entirely new, we're just doing it with a school-based teacher, nonetheless, doesn't make it any less noteworthy that those kids are, have they done their play last Friday?
It will be tomorrow.
Tomorrow
at 10:55. And actually the part of it that's new is it's flip-flop with visual arts, which we had gotten away from. So the students do happier theater arts and then happier visual arts. So that's the art scheme.
Okay, so that's out there. And then at the high school, just to call out our counseling staff there who's entered 8 years of graduation information into the Naviance system, which is something we had talked about. We talked about programming, what we spend money on, and it's a way to track our students after they leave high school so that we understand how they're doing, where they're not doing so well, and we can feed that back into what we do in high school. So 8 years of student data entry is significant. And also the fact that we're in a normal but a WASP midterm meeting within 3 years, because we got our first 6-year accreditation 3 years ago. So we're in the middle of a WASP visit there. I have no doubt that we'll fare just fine. And for those parents whose students are going up to high school in coming years, there's a tutoring program and we've expanded the tutoring offerings. Mm-hmm. Mr. DeVoe?
Yeah, every day after school, Monday through Thursday, starting on January 9th to the end of the year.
So that's what's going on at some of our other sites. As far as staff, thank you very much for your efforts this calendar year. And I wish everybody in this room a happy holiday season, healthy and happy with your families. That's it for me. Okay, moving on to item 9.0, the consent agenda. It's recommended the following consent agenda items be approved. 9.1, the minutes of the previous board meeting, December 8th, the warrant register, and a donation of an electric keyboard by Mr. Brett Leonardo to the VHS music program. Donations of this magnitude, they really help in the offerings. It's a $2,300 keyboard, so it's really thank you, Mr. Leonardo, and I I hope the students at Vasquez use it well. Anybody want to move in?
Second.
Call the question?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. 5-0-0.
Okay. So now let's move up. Item 12.1, resolution number 16-17.06. Meadowlark Elementary School, Historic Acton School Campus is the header. And it is a resolution regarding the naming of the school. And let's see if there is a resolution in here. Thank you.
I'll move the 12.1.
Second.
Mr. President.
Thank you. And seconded by Mr. Distasso. And would you, do you have anything to say to slide?
Per your request, we're submitting this for you to look over. You asked us to kind of pool the people and put together the discussion that we had last time to come up with some kind of a name for the marquee. I think the understanding was we will move the students that will remain operating as Meadowlark, but we were looking at kind of a marquee. And I also want to point out that I do have a scheduled meeting on January 3rd with some of the community members that were speaking on behalf of Acton School to talk about the lettering that was on the wall that said we were distinguished and still have the Acton name, and talk about the bell and how we're going to kind of refurbish all of that and keep it intact.
Right. The understanding at the last meeting was that we would not modify the other markings on the building other than to make them newer. That they would still read Acton Elementary School, California Senior School.
We'll work as a team and see what we can do.
Okay. What this resolution does is it specifically says, and I don't know if you said this specifically, the marquee would say Meadowlark Elementary School, Historic Acton School Campus. Any discussion? Oh,
yeah,
do
I
we have
a discussion. Okay. Oh, you have a card. Why don't we
do the
card?
Yes, you missed the card. Ms. Blah?
The other Blaha from, not Asma. My name is Debbie Blaha. Just a little about me. I've had a student here since 2002. My daughter is 25 years old and has graduated from Vasquez, went to High Desert. I have a sixth grader now at High Desert, and I also have a third grader here at Meadowlark. So we will be affected next year going to Acton School. So with that said, good evening, everybody. First, I would like to say thank you to Mark for working so hard and trying to bridge the school board, parents, and community members together. It is not an easy task. With that said, I am one of those parents who was not thrilled that their child was going to Acton School next year, but it is happening. So I think it is important, in order for us to help the children with the transition to the new campus, Acton School should have the Meadowlark name in it somewhere, so that the children that are coming here next year will still feel a part of a school that most of them have been going to since they were in kindergarten. I would hope that the superintendent, board members, and community keep the kids' best interest in mind when making their comments and decisions, and that we all want the best education for our kids. I understand that some community members are concerned that Acton School is part of Acton history, but again, so are the children. And as adults in this community, take that into consideration. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Larry, you were absent last time, so you probably
I talked to Larry and Jonathan.
Oh. Did you want to?
Yeah, please? I've got some comments I'd like to make. I've reviewed the document that Kim supplied that set forth the issues and the possible answers to those issues. I have read the extensive comments in the local newspapers, Country Journal and the Acton agua dulce news. And as I was referred to by Mark, fought very hard with him to get to keep Acton School from being closed, to get it reopened over all these years, to keep it from being sold, to keep it from being, that was to private schools, to keep it from being leased, to AV Mission College and was quoted in the Antelope Valley Press some 8 or 9 years ago of trying to stop the then board from gutting the school like a dead fish. It wasn't just a quote for the day, it was the Antelope Valley Press quote of the week. In analyzing all of the bullets that are on the analysis, I don't see anything on there overwhelming that should make us change the name from Acton School the way it's been, or I don't know, my jacket that I got at the high school hasn't, I think, when it was started years and years ago. The bullets are full of like possibilities and not known and things that would have to be done, but my view would be to do them, not to buckle down and try to call this new school something that's not. I didn't fight years ago in all these years for Meadowlark School. Meadowlark was never meant to be what they're trying to make it now, a 3 through 6 grade. It was meant from day one to be a K-2 school. I'd like to make a motion to amend the resolution to have the school keep the name of Acton Elementary School as I believe it should be. And I will see if I can get a second.
I'll second it.
So let's,
well, I may okay.
As a point of order, I don't know that we need to make an amendment or a motion, because if this were to be voted down, it remains Acton School because that's its current name. So it would remain Acton School. The name change would only occur if we approve this resolution. Yeah. So I as a point of order, I don't think we need a motion because we're just voting on a motion, which is a de facto vote on the agenda item.
And we have an open agenda item.
But Mr. Layton may not have been aware of that when this resolution came forward, it was, if there's a majority vote for this, the name would incorporate Meadowlark. If the vote goes against this, it stands as is and remains as is. So that's as a...
I just don't think it's right to change the name.
So I just add, I agree with you.
It's just a point of
in the way that it's structured.
Right.
And because you weren't at the last meeting, this is only applicable to the Marquee. And so there was a lot of discussion last meeting and some movement towards what I call the middle. And the movement towards the middle was that this would be limited only to the Marquee. Actually, what frankly I heard tonight that made me a little more alarmed, because I was part of that moving towards the middle, was I was very clear at the last meeting that this would not affect the other letters on the building. It will only be modernized, but it would still say Acton School or Acton Elementary, the California
It does a school.
No, I heard something different tonight. I heard that in January we're going to talk about that signage too. That's what I heard. So that's a step-by-step process of more rebranding.
When we left
here last 2 weeks ago, it was exclusive to the Marquee. And then we'd said, you know, as people maybe get more comfortable, maybe we can change the Marquee back in the future. And so now it's becoming, it's sounding like it's maybe.
Well, so let's ask them.
Let's ask her if there's evolving, because I didn't pick that up.
That was one of my concerns, actually.
When we left here, it was suggested that I check with ASMA, PTO, and Women's Club on the Marquee. And putting together, that's where we came up with all of this, with the Meadowlark Elementary School Historic Acton School Campus. In that discussion, a community member that spoke yesterday has contacted me several times about the actual wall that had the lettering on it that Will pointed out last time had rotten, or rotten, you know, just in paint, the building had to come down. So in the meantime, we kind of put together a beautiful plaque, and that's why you see the word plaque, that has Acton's name, that has the date it won the Distinguished School Award, and it would be highlighted by a light at night so that you could see it where it would replace the lettering. In speaking to this community member, she wants to meet with a few other people to see if that's something that they're interested in, because they want to keep that history or put the letters back.
Sure.
Either way,
okay.
I don't know if you want to weigh in on that.
So it's an appearance issue versus a wording issue.
No, but
wait. We're talking about the other markage on the wall.
Yes.
We'll come back to this, if you will. I mean, we all thought we heard the same thing last week, and or 2 weeks ago. I want to ensure that. So these further discussions were how we might make it bolder, or we knew 2 weeks ago that we, because the old letters are wood and rotting, that they would be remanufactured.
Right.
But we're not talking about changing the nomenclature on the wall.
No, we're still talking about keeping Acton School, Distinguished School,
yes.
Award.
Not renaming it the Historic School.
The year in which it was, no, the
year
in which it was.
Part of Meadowlark School.
Correct.
Right. Mr. President?
Keeping the wall intact.
So, but how many schools are we opening? Two elementaries, as it says in the resolution, or one?
Okay, may I, for one moment, then, only because I want to bring Larry fully up to speed. And you're right about your reading of the bullet point. So I will say that 2 weeks ago at this meeting, we also learned and got to the point where what you do in county paperwork and the way you fill out your paperwork is a disjointed discussion to what you put on the marquee and brand the outside of the school. And therefore, those discussion points are really moot to the conversation here, which is what we put on the wall. And so, because as we know, interim superintendent told us last time, the paperwork, the lay code, the statistical scoring, that can all be done under Meadowlark or sharing the principal. We really did get to the point, I'm trying to get back to that middle ground, where we're only talking about the marquee. Because there was a lot of discussion and there are a lot of interested parties. So all we're talking about here today is the marquee, and there's an understanding that the other marquee on the building will remain as is, albeit modernized, but terminology.
Then what does it mean in the paragraph here of the resolution that we're going to vote on, where it says, be it resolved if in the future we need two elementary schools, it will be readdressed. We need two elementary schools now, the reopening of the old Acton School. That's two.
I understand. Again, this is last week's conversation. And so, really, we are running two geographic locations as Meadowlark School. We have one administrative staff, one school code, all of the amalgamation of the data, one SARC report, because we're not necessarily ready at this point in time, and we didn't allocate budget necessarily, let's say, for another principal. And now we may grow into that, but at this point, It's a second location for mechanically Meadowlark School.
Sounds to me like you're calling a giraffe an elephant, but it's still a giraffe.
No. Now, what we meant by this be it resolved last paragraph, at some future time, certainly we could entertain its own principal. We could entertain more grades there. We could entertain its own PTSO, which, you know, that would be up to the parents. And at that point in time, certainly we could entertain changing the marquee to show a little bit more independence. That's where we arrived 2 weeks ago, so I just want you to know the conversation that we have.
And we agreed that this is
now.
Right. We have agreed there that this is not basically an opening of a new school. This is the housing of two grades. from its school that's at full capacity. And I just wanted to, for a public's benefit, read this resolution, which is pretty short. Basically, it says Meadowlark School is currently at capacity, okay? Students in grades 4 and 5, 4th and 5th grades, will be moved to the newly remodeled historic Acton School Campus at the start of 2016-2017 school year. This is the meat of it here. Be it resolved, Meadowlark Elementary School will continue to operate at both facilities. Meadowlark Elementary School will continue to operate at both facilities. The marquee will state Meadowlark Elementary School - Historic Acton School Campus. The historic distinguished school plaque will be remodeled and continue to be displayed. The Acton School will be required.
Bell. School bell.
School bell will be repainted and remain intact. Okay? Sorry, I forgot my glasses. So, and then be it resolved in the future, if in the future the enrollment increases, requiring the need to open 2 elementary schools, the reopening of Acton Elementary School will be readdressed at that time. So that's basically what this resolution is. And we have a resolution open on the floor. It's been open and seconded. And that's, if this doesn't pass, in effect, what you're saying will come to be.
If it doesn't pass, the name will not change. It's all over.
Yeah.
Now, if I may, now that you're up in the history, I agree with you. I think that we can transition kids. I don't think that we should incrementally erase the history of that location. And I think that incrementally, right? First it's the marquee, and
that was
maybe something else. And it is very, very intrinsic to what this town is. I'm celebrating the fact that we're reopening that physical location and that we have students there. Part of the reason I'm celebrating it is because it's Acton School. And, for me, again, I'll say it again this week, there's very few things that define Acton substantially as the school, the cemetery, and maybe the 128-year-old church. This is what is Acton to me. And I make an analogy, and I'll say it again, and it's like renaming Vasquez Rocks. So I do understand, but this is bigger, and we'll get past it. This is just fundamentally some of the history of this town. And as I said before, in nuts and bolts, we're all still gonna call it Acton School. It's been there too long as that. It's too awkward to say something else. When we talk about the remodeling project, how's it going over at Acton School? So for many reasons, I actually will vote similar to you, Larry. For those of my other board members who maybe are still sitting the fence, I'll ask them to look at this from the long view. I mean, we have a very impassioned person talking about, although I don't think it was substantiated, erasing history at Vasquez, that we actually addressed here tonight. I don't want to talk about erasing history at Acton School. So I think we can get through it with other ways. Joint programs. I mean, we talked about this last week. Carting the kids back and forth for assemblies so they're still seeing the younger kids. The fact that their teachers are moving with them. So I think there's other ways to ease that transition. So that's how I'll be voting. I'll ask you guys to consider that from a 20-year Acton resident myself.
Mike, I'd like to say that I'm addressing this specifically from what administration first, that if, and I'm going to the first bullet, if we reopen the school using the previous name, there are certain things it says we need to do. Notify the county, state, and federal government of this new school in our district for the 2017-2018 school year. I believe we should do that. It says if we will build the school, we need to put it into the student database, ARES, and remove it from Meadowlark School.
I believe we should do that.
Why do you think that that's imperative that we do that now?
Because this is Acton School. This isn't Meadowlark Annex.
Well, I understand, but you can phase things in. I don't think you need to start collecting and writing SARC reports separately. It's one administration.
It's just housing the fourth and fifth grade, Larry. It's not, Acton School's not opening.
And that's really why we tried.
It's just housing the fourth and fifth grade. That's how I look at it.
And that's why we tried to narrow the scope of this conversation to signage and of the Marquee specifically.
Yeah.
But that resolution doesn't limit it to that.
We can amend the resolution.
So let me, again, as a point of order, two people who are apparently agreeing are vehemently disagreeing with each other. So we've got to make sure that we
one has yet to speak yet.
So we need to make sure, either am I.
Perfect. Maybe we should do that soon.
Well, we'll get around to it, Ken.
Okay.
We'll get around to it. I'm trying to cover a point of order here. If we don't, you know what, Mr. President? It's skewed right now. You cannot take a vote with what Larry is saying. He's going to have to make a motion to change everything because that's not part of the resolution. And I think Mr. Layton needs to understand that he's running risk with Title I funds.
Yes.
By doing this, and I don't think he's fully alerted on the issue. So if we're not ready to vote on it, let's not make this mistake.
That's what it comes down to me.
Because if you want to do what you're saying, Larry,
like
we
said,
are going to have to make motions. Because the resolution does not include changing all of this stuff. There's a whole series of complicated issues here.
The bullet says Title I funds, and it recalls it may or may not be allowable. So,
do you remember in 2003 with an old school board that you fought like hell with as well? Who said, well, we may get a bond, we may not. Oh, we'll just roll the dice. Are you willing to go back 15 years and start rolling the dice again?
No, I'm willing to keep us having Acton School reopened the way we've been saying
anyway,
for years.
We're not opening.
Okay,
we're not reopening.
Mr. President, I have completed my statement about point of order.
Okay.
And I'm still going to reserve my right to speak, but if you want to have Ken speak on the issue.
Thank Mr. Paulsgraf?
I had these notes written down before, and so here's my understanding, and I think it's fairly clear, that the Acton School, the California Distinguished School, the signage that was on the building that had to be removed, and the anchors removed to paint the building and do what needed to be done, and the brickwork needed to be removed, and it's my understanding that will go back in the same place as period appropriate as is humanly possible.
Correct.
There we go. Okay, so that took care of one thing for me. The next thing is the bell. I don't think we should paint the bell. I think the bell should be looked at because I don't want to be watching Antiques Roadshow 30 years from now. Had you not painted this bell, it would be worth $47 million, but now it's worth $20. So it's also my understanding that you have reached out to different groups, including these ladies here, as well as some others, and it's amicable, and things are moving ahead, and you have a meeting on January 3rd with this group of people without this to put some final details on the understanding that no one is throwing the sign away, no one is moving the sign, and we're not going to sandblast the bell. So that's kind of what that meeting is about. What I'm voting for here is that Historic Acton School will be preserved through those two steps of the bell being recognized historically and the original signage. And that resolution, it's my understanding that if someone were to come ahead and say, okay, well, we're going to do this now and that, it would take another resolution of the board at that time. So we don't play with those things once they're preserved. But that the reopening of that school to house students that are here, those students require relief in the way of their surroundings, the capacity that's at the school, and the resources that they have available to them, okay? So it's two different things. I can feel like I want to look at my postcard collection while this place is jammed with kids and cars and all that thing, but the capacity has been reached here. And I don't think there are any details embedded in there where, you know, stuff is being tied on, snuck in, and, you know, there's some secret deal. I don't see it. I see it limited to what I just said. And that said, I'm not interested at all, or nor will I support, the fragmenting of our programs that affect our most vulnerable students. So in your packet is this report on the Williams legislation that basically looks at how some of your most vulnerable Title I students are doing here. And they come in and audit you in one way or another. And on page 3, it tells us that 3% or 3 classes that are in the school that was looked at, I don't want to drill down into that, have more than 20% English learners, that 3 of those classes have teachers who hold the appropriate authorizations, but it doesn't say anything about how those kids are actually doing. So you've got English learners, a sizable percentage of English learners, but you've got teachers in place. And that doesn't mean they're going to do well. That may mean they're going to do great or not. But what if that just happens to be 2 classrooms here that we send over there and then fragment that population out from the rest of this population? So we've got about 500 kids here. And we take it over there, and now all of a sudden they look like they're 80 kids. What happens to those scores, and what happens to how the school looks, and what happens to their funding? It tanks out. I can't support that.
Well, see, the reason why the argument for leaving it as Meadowlark School is to prevent exactly that. Because the state recognizes that we can house them in another state, for God's sake, okay, but it's still Meadowlark. That it's acceptable to house them in another facility if this one is full.
But still not take away the support.
And it addresses all your concerns by making it Meadowlark Historic Acton School. What Larry is addressing.
Got a couple more things, and I'll wrap it up.
But what Larry is addressing impacts all the things you're saying.
But I can't have that. I will not vote for that. I will not vote for just leaving that school being named what it is, so we can take these classes of English learners, dump them in there, lose their support, lose their funding, and make it look like its own school with very poor performance. I will not support that. What else I will not support is I will not support gutting out the PTO operation of everybody's working together. I'm sure, like I said last time, sometimes people don't get my humor, but the kids are going there, they're going to have the same parents. And I don't think that they're going to get a new parent, or those parents that go over there are going to just disown these people. They're going to continue to work and support each other with the limited funds they have. So for those reasons, if we can't separate the difference between a sign on a wall that everyone has said numerous times is going to stay like it is. Is it going to stay like it is?
Yes.
Perfect. And you're not going to melt the bell or grind it down?
No.
Perfect. So that takes care of Historic Acton School. And now we've got, I don't want my kids' classes gutted out, and I don't want the PTO gutted out. So if we want to change everything, then we need to table this until we get the thing in order. But I'm in support of the resolution the way it stands.
So just for point of order, all those discussions would only have been if we entertain a change as Larry was proposing. But that's not what's here.
That's not what you're proposing.
That's correct. All that's here is, folks, we're just voting on the name of the marquee. That's all.
And for the sake of clarity, if we had Acton School having K through 5 or K through 6, do you think anyone will be talking about naming it Meadowlark or having any type of Meadowlark thing on there? It would be Acton School. It would be, you know, unfathomable to rename it. We're basically taking the 4th and 5th graders, exactly as this resolution says, and housing them 3/4 of a mile down the street at another one of our campuses. That's all it is. That's all we're doing. If Acton School was reopening, I mean, come on. We wouldn't have 2 schools with the same name. We're not reopening Acton School as much as I would love that. We have just over 1,000 students. We can't have, you know, 2 elementary schools. That's why agua dulce closed and we have a charter there now. We don't have the population to support 2-3 different elementary schools, unfortunately. Hopefully one day we'll go back to 2,600 kids. My son was in kindergarten back in 2005. Hopefully, we'll go back to that. However, if we just look at this at what it is, the housing of fourth and fifth graders, it doesn't make sense to do anything other than what the resolution said. And as such, I'm going to support the resolution. That's it, Mr. President.
Did you have anything else?
Yeah, oh yeah.
So, what I have, President.
There are buildings, more so back east than there are on the west coast, because things tend to fall on the west coast. But we still have buildings that are historic in nature that are littered across our countryside, that are bank buildings, business offices that weren't built as a bank or a business office. They were an old hotel or whatever. And yet you still find the name, you find the plaque, the history isn't lost. The history is actually celebrated. I'm sure your city has them. I know my city did.
You can't breathe without a cultural designation.
There you go. They're all over the place. And, you know, we have ways of being able to preserve our past and our identity. That's one. Number two, I'm going to go back to what is a sensitive point for me that I addressed last week. When we have a community that seems to be split in half about what kind of pizza they like, everything we do, there's half for it and half against it. It's just the nature of our community, which can make it difficult to govern. So when you're in those kinds of circumstances, it's my experience that you look to who your immediate stakeholders are, the ones who are going to be impacted the most. And to me, those are the Meadowlark parents. Okay. From a policy perspective, from a school board member perspective, I don't think it should really matter necessarily what we all personally think. We should be trying to figure out a way to carve out a solution that is representative of the feedback of the community. And I believe the extended stakeholders, the community members who are not part of the parent community, I believe we have figured out a way to do that. And Ms. Mattson seemed to have gotten comfortable with, okay, that sounded pretty good to her. And I only mention her because she was one of the more vocal people here representing the Acton school name. So what's still being lost is the parent community who feel the need to maintain continuity, to have identity with Meadowlark School. We have their kids who they know their kids better than we do. We don't know their kids like parents know their kids. And they're suggesting it would be better of a transition to maintain that connection. After all, as of now, they're still maintaining the same principle. And there's already, because change is difficult, there's already sensitivity on the part of fourth and fifth grade parents and pensiveness about the move. So we should be doing everything we can to ameliorate that, to recognize the parent concerns and to make this transition as absolutely as smooth as possible. And we have the ability to do that tonight by having the school named as Meadowlark, but also containing the name of a school has stood there for over 100 years or nearly 100 years, which is important. So I would ask that we not make more controversy out of something than it deserves, that we can achieve both issues here and recognize what parents are telling us. We were elected to represent the community. And unless the community is suggesting that we do something immoral or illegal, I think we have a duty to represent community interests.
And we have a split community interest, and I think we have effectively, from what I can garner in talking to both sides, we've effectively addressed that here. And so I will close with saying that I cannot and will not support Mr. Layton's recommendation that we make it Acton School, that we change everything, that we make staff do all this extra work, that we put Title I funds at risk, and that we do all of this effort when there is no need to do it. There's absolutely no need to do it. And we're only moving 150 kids over. We're only partially reopening the school. We only have funds to refurbish a portion of the school. Someday, Larry, that's gonna turn into a 3.5 or a 3.6 or whatever it's gonna turn into. And I would be supporting Acton School and making it the way it was once upon a time. But I'm certainly not gonna ask the PTO, for instance, to start producing two sets of sweatshirts for their kids and t-shirts, Meadowlark and Acton, and have to change their bylaws and do all these other things. I believe that's an undue burden and it's an unnecessary burden. I believe we've reached our effective compromise here.
If I may, and I wasn't going to share this, but I think I will. Mark, when you bring up the students, there's a fourth grader that wrote to her class, and it was on a wall, and it was sent to me yesterday, and I thought, well, if it comes up, it's appropriate. But you're talking about one of the students that will be moving. And it says, if I were to get the first gift of Christmas, I would choose a bigger school. I would choose this because even though we don't have a lot of kids in our little town, we should still always have more room for education. And I think it goes back to, and you know, I flippantly said at one point, I don't care what we call it, we've got 150 kids coming to this campus, and let's keep the focus on them.
Absolutely. Thank you, Ms. Lytle. I agree with you. So as the president, I get to close, and so this is just about the Marquee folks. Whether or not the position I advocate wins the night, I'm not that attached to it, but we're just talking about the Marquee. Having said that, I don't want to see a gradual rebranding in the school. You know, it'll always be Acton School to most of us in this community. Is everybody ready for a vote?
Yes.
Ready? Okay. Call the question.
Okay, well, let's, because we had so many things on the table, Mr. President, I'd ask that we
clarify
that we're voting on the resolution
as
written and stated.
We're voting on the resolution as written. Call the question?
Aye.
Aye.
Nay.
Nay.
The ayes have it.
3-0. I'm sorry, 3-0.
Okay. Thank you, folks. Next up,
do we want to report out on the
yes,
superintendent?
That's,
I don't know if parents
up
want to hear it or not hear it.
Yeah. You guys might be interested in the report out from closed session, which is what we'll do now, which is 15.0. In closed session, the board voted 5-0-0, which means it carried unanimously, to appoint Ms. Lytle interim superintendent February 1st, 2017, and direct counsel to negotiate an appropriate contract modification with her, and we will bring that back for a vote when that's ready.
Congratulations.
And thank you for stepping up. Thank you. We also took a vote that was 3 in favor and 2 against to seek Dr. Woodard as a consultant, effective February 1st, 2017, and direct counsel to negotiate a contract with him that would also be brought back for a specific council vote. And that motion, as I said, carried 3-2-0.
And I believe the minutes should reflect, at least as to me, I was a vote against it.
Okay. Let the minutes reflect it.
I as well.
And then by default, Mr. Distasso, Mr. Porter, Mr. Fox voted in favor of retaining Dr.
Dr. Woodard as a consultant to ease the transition.
And that we directed, I'm sorry.
And that we directed council to negotiate a contract.
Yep.
All right, that's closed session. So now we'll resume the agenda in its order, which would have us start with 10.1, the personal action report. And it's recommended the board approve the personal action report. The personal action report recognizes the superintendent's resignation effective January 31st and includes two hires. Ms. Lytle, do you have anything to add?
I just wanted to point out, as you already have, Dr. Woodard's resignation, and I really want to thank him for all of his service, and it was such a while of his endeavors as far as you seeking me to be the interim. It's nothing but an honor. I've grown to love this district in the year and a half I've been here, and I hope I can do the justice that he's done to the district in the last 8 years, and I appreciate that.
We'll support you all the way.
I made a mistake. I should have asked somebody to move it in first.
So. Yeah, so moved.
So, a second?
I'll second. Thank you.
Now I'd like to make those comments appropriately at the right time. Did what I just said.
Any other discussion?
Just repeat yourself.
Call the question.
Aye.
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 10.2, Director, Elementary, Middle School, High School, Principal Job Description. It's recommended the board approve the director slash principal job description for the elementary, middle, and high schools as it's presented.
So moved.
Thank you.
Second.
Thank you. Ms. Lytle.
This is a job description that's bringing back to you for revision on the work year. It was originally written that the director of either the elementary and or the middle and or the high school principal would all work 215 days. It's been known that the high school principal slash director works 225. So we want to alter the work year depending on the assignment that you're given. So at the elementary school, it would be a 215-day, like it was stated earlier, and then you can see in bold that we're looking at 220 and 225 for the middle school and high school.
Is the pay scale just extrapolated based on days, roughly?
Yes.
Thank you. That's what comes up next. Any other discussion?
I beg just a moment. No, good. Call the question?
Aye.
5-0-0.
Okay, now we'll move on to 10.3, the certificated salary schedule. It's recommended the board approve the certificated salary schedule C as presented. Do I have a move?
I'll move.
I'll second.
Okay, Ms. Lytle.
And this is where the salaries and the questioning plays out. You can see that in bold, we altered the school year for the middle school principal to be 220. It used to say 215. And then we altered all of the pay scales so that the middle school principal would get 5 more days of pay, and then the high school would be paid 10 more days of pay, and she's already been working.
Any other discussion?
Mr. President, I'd like to present a motion to add and clarify that for the affected middle and high school principals, that if salary C were to be approved, that it be retroactive for those two to July 1st of 2016.
I would second that.
Thank you.
So again, as a point of order, when we vote, we'll be voting on the approval of the salary and the retroactive pay.
To the appropriate number of days in the year, this school year.
Correct, for the days that they haven't gotten paid.
Thank you.
Correct.
And once again, that this pay scale hike is extrapolated roughly based on the number of days divided out and then added. Okay.
Correct.
Yeah.
And
that one.
Is that all the board?
Yes.
Okay, yeah. I'll just add that if you'll notice, the job description was inconsistent with the old table. So, a great deal is clerical cleanup. It's not clerical if you're not receiving the salary that really intended with the work days that are being worked. And so, for me, this rights are wrong.
call the question?
Aye.
Aye. Item 11.1, Williams Legislation Executive Summary and Second Quarter Report. The district publicly reports information regarding Williams lawsuit settlements pertaining to instructional materials facilities and teacher vacancies and misassignments. Do I have a move?
I'll bring
the closure. Second. Okay.
There's no vote.
And there's no vote. It's just to bring it in.
Mr. President, again, I'd like to drive the point home that based on the results of this audit, it's an annual audit, there's no legal action or anything that goes with this. But based on the results that we do have English learner classes of more than 20%, that we do have the teachers that are, again, it's a, I don't want to beat a dead horse, but going back to the point about Meadowlark School, this is a perfect example of why we would not fragment something over a name and make these scores look lower or artificially inflate them.
Very good point. Thank you. Okay, anything else? Item 12, let's see, 12.1 we did already, right?
And that was 3.2.
Yep, I wrote it down on the paper. Okay, we're up to 12.2, thank you, Mr. Porter. This is a sunshine enclosure, is what 12.2 is, and it's to present the Acton Agua Dulce Teachers Association's initial proposal for negotiations to the Acton Agua Dulce Unified School District for the 2016-17 school year. Do we have a motion?
Move.
Second? I'll do it. And just so people understand, before we get into the nuts and bolts of this, there's a certain structure here. We bring in the teachers, sunshine, we have a hearing, and then we'll take an action, and then we'll do the same three steps for the district's sunshining. So now we're speaking specifically to the sunshining that the AAPA brought in. So do we have a, yep.
Seems to me we should be doing the hearing before the.
Well, we're not accepting it. I guess we're.
Oh, yeah, it's okay. We're fine. We're fine.
Okay. All right.
You just be absent.
It's just we're just presenting, so
okay.
It's fine.
That's right. All right. We'll take a vote on the matter.
Aye.
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 4-0-1.
Strike the vote. I was keyed off of what was printed there. Okay, so now let's go to the hearing, 12.3, which is a hearing regarding the Acton Agua Dulce Teachers Association initial proposals for negotiation for the 2016-2017 school year. This is an opportunity for the public to comment on the AAPA's initial proposal for negotiations. Item 12.4 is an action.
It's actually the same thing.
It's to acknowledge receipt. Right?
Yeah.
So,
so moved.
We brought it in.
So moved.
We commented. Now we're going to take an action. It's moved by Mr. Porter.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Distasso. Call the question.
Aye.
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 Thank you.
And Mr. Falskive on 12.2.
Well, there's no app.
We yes, I
we voted in there. So.
I don't vote on that.
Okay. Which is 12.5, which where there also will be no vote on by similarity. We're going to present the Acton Agua Dulce Unified School District's initial proposal for negotiations to the AAATA for 2016 and 2017 school year.
So moved.
Second. Okay. now let's open a public hearing on said subject. Opening at 9:02. Not seeing any cards or public comment, so we'll close at 9:03. Action 12.7, acknowledge receipt of the Acton Agua Dulce Unified School District's initial proposal for negotiations for the 2016-17 school year.
Move.
Second. Any discussion? Call the question?
Aye.
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 Thank you. Okay. 12.8, California Fencing Contract Project Number 01-1622, wrought iron fencing for Acton School. It's recommended the board approve California Fencing Contract Number 01-1622 for wrought iron fencing at the Acton School. Do I have a
move?
Yeah.
Second.
Any discussion?
I can answer any question.
So I have some discussion.
Sure.
So I've looked at the scope of work, and it's a significant scope of work. What we're talking about is fencing that will match both Vasquez High School, and everybody knows the improvements that we had with the fencing over at High Desert School. And so it would be the same thing, but now at Acton School. It's a significant amount of work. There's over 1,000 feet of industrial grade wrought iron, three drive-through gates, two walk-through gates. So it's a significant work package. You know, of course, I feel that it's a good value for our dollar and a needed improvement for the site. That's my position. I just want people to know how much we're really talking about here, and that it will match the other two schools. So you get. Any other discussion?
The suggestion I would make is on the agenda, if it's going to approve the contract, then maybe the dollar value of the contract would be written out. Were there other bids?
Yes.
And this was the lowest responsible?
Yes.
Thank you.
The dollar value is 149.
Thank you.
142.
142.
Okay. Call the question?
Aye.
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 Item 12.9, Ontario refrigeration contract for HVAC, high volume AC.
I'll second.
At Acton School. Mark open. Ed seconded. Any discussion?
My understanding is that bidding is required at $88,000 and up.
Yes.
So did we get any other price quotes on this work?
Not for this work.
Is there a reason why?
I don't know a reason why.
Okay.
This is below $88,000, but I'm understanding that.
We only had one submittal, is that right?
Two
submittals.
This was the lowest.
That answers my question perfectly.
Sure.
Thank you, Will.
Sure.
And again, the amount of the contract was? 53, thank you.
Fair enough.
That was with the question mark at the end of the
question. It's all posted, it's probably later
yeah,
in the package.
Yeah, but like I said, it's better if
well,
it's here with
people. That's another way of doing it. It's also in
correct.
The package.
59.4.
Okay. Package, okay. Call the question?
Aye.
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 Carried, 5-0. And okay, future agenda items, there are none there. Does anybody have a suggestion? Okay, item 14, calendar for our future board meetings. There'll be a board meeting January 12th here at 7:30, and a board meeting January 26th. And that should say 2017 under the next to the January 12th, obviously.
It's going to be written up later.
It's okay. Happy holidays. I think we all knew it wasn't going to be last January. And there'll be one January 26, 2017, here at 7:30.
Are they going to be here at Meadowlark?
At this point, that's what it says.
That would be to be determined.
I have not.
I just heard a rumor that we were going to be in there in January.
It's looking really good, so if we need to change the location.
It's great in here too. They're both great.
It's exciting.
It's beautiful. I saw it.
And we already reported out on closed session.
It's the Brooklyn Dodger.
Have you seen Ruby hanging inside the interview?
You're losing.
Yeah, I know.
We're losing it over here.
Mr. Distasso.
Yes, sir.
This is my tutor on appropriate presidenting. We reported out, is there any specific, do we have to move and second the report out?
What, you did that?
Yeah, we did that at the time.
You moved it? You originally forgot, but you went back and we moved it in?
Oh, we did.
VPN.
And so it's all covered, and so we've already done all of that.
Very good. I know it's already reported.
So we are happily at adjournment.
Okay, adjourning. We are at nine.
So moved for adjournment.
Second, moved by Ms. Porter, seconded by Mark Distasso. Call the question?
Aye.
Name.
Aye.
Aye.